Morning. Welcome to Westside. Let's open in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord God, it is good to be in your house, Lord. Father, you're Lord, you're King, you're our God, Lord, and we worship you and you alone, Lord.
Yeah.
Yield our lives to you. Jesus, we give you all the glory this day. And Jesus, that's what our heart's desire is to do this day through our church service, Lord. As the majority of folks that are tuning in are all over the web, Lord, whether we're all gathered here in the building or wherever we're gathered, Lord God, we are your church. No matter if we're a longtime member of Westside or we're a first-time visitor watching our service today, Lord God, we pray that you touch each one on what they might need this day. Take this service and use it for your glory, every piece and every part, Lord God. We would give it to you this day. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right, good morning, Westside. We're just glad to worship with you this morning, wherever you are, in your pajamas or here, you know, just praising the Lord together. We're going to sing a couple songs together. Thank you.
Each and every one of you. We're especially thankful for those of you that are watching online.
I know it's different.
It starts.
Service, you'll be sure, want to be sure to be here for that. But I want to share something with our kids this morning, and I want to, you know, just call out these boys and girls. Well, I won't call their names out, but you know who you are. I appreciate all our boys and girls that we get to minister to on Sunday mornings. We have Sunday school classes for kindergarten to third grade, up to fifth grade, as well as for youth and adults. But I appreciate those kids as much now as ever, and maybe that's what God's doing in our hearts, to be thankful for the for what we have in our lives. But I know Miss Beth and I are thankful for the kids that we get to teach in Sunday schools. We're missing that right now. And I know Brother Johnny and Miss Janice, as well as those other Sunday school teachers, are missing that. For you kids, I want to just kind of remember what we've been learning on Wednesday nights of Building Hope. So we've been going over the Ten Commandments, and we've made it through six, I believe. And if you'll notice, boys and girls, the Ten Commandments are ten, but they're kind of broken up a little bit. If you look at the first four, they really speak to our relationship to God, okay? And it tells us that you'll have no other gods before me, do not make for yourself an idol, should not use the Lord's name in vain or in a disrespectful way, and then to honor the Sabbath. To make it holy. But then after that, it goes into our parents and our relationship with our parents and how we treat other people. So we go with our relationship with God and then with those around us. And really, Jesus kind of emphasized that, if you will, when he was being asked about the greatest commandment. And in Mark 12, and they're questioning Jesus, which is they were willing to do, one of the leaders of the day, religious leaders, whether they were scribes or Pharisees or Sadducees, whoever, was always wanting to catch him, trick him. Of course, he was far more wise than they were. Even knew what they were going to ask before they asked it. But in this case, they were asking him, what was the greatest commandment? And really, Jesus' answer was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then the second, he said, the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. So if you look at the Ten Commandments, it kind of goes that way. Those first four tell us to love the Lord God and our relationship to Him. And those next six are about our neighbors, those around us. And we won't get into who our neighbor is today, but maybe that's something we can explore in the coming weeks as we look at different stories in the Bible. But if we're focusing on the Ten Commandments, I thought that was good this morning to share with you. But that's what Jesus wants for us. And not just for boys and girls out there that are listening. This is for everyone. He wants us to love Him first. With everything that we have, everything we're capable of doing, and it's not going to be perfect. My goodness, the Lord knows my history, my past, the things that I have in my lives, boys and girls, the mistakes, if you will, but the grace of God is sufficient and has taken care of those things for me and continues to, really. It's forgiven me of my sin, disbelief, forgiven me of many other sins that I've had in my life. It's helped change me. But Jesus doesn't want you to change first, boys and girls. He wants you to come to Him. He'll help you with the things that need to go from your life. And I would just encourage you this week, boys and girls, as you're trying to do online learning, working from home, it's different. In some cases, it might be difficult. But I would just encourage you to continue learning. Continue being respectful, like we talked about last week, to your parents. Whatever that is for you, whether it's mom and dad, whether it's your dad or your mom you live with, your aunt and uncle, your grandma, granddaddy, whoever you live with, I just want you to treat them with the utmost respect. And like I said, do your best to love the Lord God with all you can, all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor. And you can start that and practice that in your own home with your brothers and sisters and your parents and then those around you. We're not trying to be around too many others right now, but as we kind of come out of this eventually, and we will, boys and girls, this won't last forever. I've had my own kids asking, what happens this, that? There's a season of time, and when we get to the other side, I think God wants us to do things a little different, treat each other a little different, behave a little different. And we can follow Scripture if we want to know a plan to love Him first with everything we have, and to love our neighbors like we love ourselves. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the opportunity to share with boys and girls this morning. Pray that some are able to listen wherever they are, Lord God, whether they're on live stream or they're on Facebook. Or if they're a visitor, whoever needed to hear that this morning, Lord, I just pray that you might use the words that it's nothing that I would say, but what comes from your word yourself, Lord, from your Ten Commandments, from your greatest commandment, Jesus. Help us to do that each and every day, whether we're quarantined, Lord, or whether we're on the other side of everything going on right now. We give you the glory and praise and honor, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Yeah.
Thank you, Bob. One thing I meant to mention to you, Bob, as a way of announcement, for the ladies in the Growing Girlfriends class, they're going to be having a conference call tomorrow night at 7:15. And if you haven't heard from Vicki, or if you are not aware of that, if you want to contact her, please do, and she'll include you in on that, get all that set up on that conference call, and that way you can actually have a time where you can talk together and share. And on that same line, too, I want to just kind of encourage you all, you know, you can do this. You as Bible study teachers, you as leaders, you can get on Facebook, you can get download Zoom, you can connect with your classes, you can talk with them. And I just encourage you, if the Lord's pushing you maybe to do something, stay connected in a different way, do that. You know, try to start that this week and just make sure that that we are the church, being the church, and just encourage one another and love each other the best way we can, social distance wise. So, this next song we're going to sing is called Living Hope. And let me read you 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 says, "Praise be the God of the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So this song is fairly popular, but we as believers, we have a living hope. We're not just hoping for hope's sake that things will do this, or that, you know, our favorite team will win the pennant this year. We have a living hope that is based in a resurrected living Savior. So just remember that as we worship this morning. And together, let's continue to worship and sing. Yeah. chorus to this song that I know a lot of you are familiar with.
When
situation, did they realize that there is a greater thirst that the world can't satisfy, and it's for the living water? John 4:13 reads, Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
Comfort for family, protection while we sleep.
Great job, Wayne. Really appreciate that. Such a poignant song. This moment in time. That song has ministered probably to some of you over the years. For me, it has ministered to me at different times. If you know the story, Laura Story's husband, I think, was something tragically happened to him, and that's what came out of her testimony and what she had gone through in her life. Thank you, Wayne. That's awesome. Great stuff. Appreciate you and John. And I'll say thank you again to Ralph, who's manning the camera this morning. Darren's in the sound booth. And we've got Brother Jim, who's been here supporting us as well, doing things. And Wobie and Brother Johnny's here as well, supporting his sweet wife singing this morning. And we are socially distancing. The only ones that are breaking the rules are Johnny and Lane, but they're socially distancing together anyway. So I know some of you might have been concerned last week. My wife's trying to make sure I'm socially distancing somebody. I'm socially distancing this morning. When I started thinking about this, you know, as you read, and my goodness, I would encourage you just in the midst of all this, you're probably seeking God maybe in ways maybe you never have before. I don't know. For maybe reading and looking and searching and praying. You're like me, you're reading and you're looking deeper into things you read. Shared in our outline here that just around, I guess, the time this kind of really started heating up, if you will, the virus, coronavirus, COVID-19, or whatever you want to call it today. I was in Daniel and had been reading there, just had finished up and had reading. Something called me to, I think someone shared something about the 33rd chapter of Ezekiel, and I looked over in there about a watchman and was reading that, studying on that a little bit. And my mother-in-law said, read Psalm 107. She had shared that with Beth. And so I read that. That's interesting. Then reading John. I said, well, what does the Lord want me to say out of John? And as I was reading that, I was initially thought I was going somewhere with it. And God said, I want you to go here today.
Yeah.
Because I think a lot of us are going around saying, what to do? You know, I don't remember the story of Chicken Little, but I remember the story of the sky's falling. So it's kind of a little bit of a play on that. But and maybe this is not so much of a panic to what to do, but it's more of a what to do. What could I do? What should I do in the midst of all this? When we have so much information that comes our way, right? I think the best advice anyone could give anyone right now, whether it comes from me, and I've heard it from many others, whether it be from, you know, in our internal group that, you know, the deacons and John, we talk to each other and share, whether we text, or we've had our first deacon leadership meeting last Sunday over Zoom, which was a new thing. We do that at work a little bit, and many others do too, but so we're all trying to do some different things, and we're just praying through. Now, what can we do? What should we do? You know, as you're trying to make decisions for your family, for a church, if you will. Like I said, Brother John's doing some great things, and I just appreciate him. And this is not a John Weldon celebration today. It's about Jesus. But he's doing it all for him. He's doing it all in the name of Christ, and he's doing some things for the church. There's some different times, difficult ways. But he is just doing a great job through it all, as well as some others too. So I just appreciate John again. And before I really get into the message, I think I would share something with you out there. If there's anyone who's searching for God in the midst of this, maybe this is for someone who's not in a relationship with the Lord, and you're saying, you know, why would God allow these things to happen in our lives? Why does God do this, that, or the other thing? And I'm not really going there because I can't answer for God. But what I can tell you is what Jesus commanded from the very beginning of his earthly ministry, when he started his earthly ministry. You know, that was around the time he was 30, and he started preaching, repent and believe.
That's right.
And we know John the Baptist had that same message, to repent and believe. What are we repenting from? We're repenting from disbelief. Belief in ourselves, a belief in some other God that we put at the top of our lives, a belief in some addiction we have in our lives when we struggle in life, we run to, a belief in our job, that our job is our security, or whoever, some personality, whether that person be even a famous preacher on TV, a famous athlete, or if our parents are believers. You see, God wants us to personally decide on Him, to choose Him. That's why Jesus said, repent, believe, turn from the sin of disbelief, believing in anything else for salvation, and turning to Him. To repent means to do a 180. We're turning away from the sin of disbelief and turning to believe in Him. Because something you have to understand in your lives, if you're like me, I became a believer at the age of 17. And I put my faith and trust in Him, and I'm calling it, if you will, I've heard it said before, get your fire insurance. And I think that's basically what I did at the time. I got my fire insurance.
Amen.
Because for a few years after that, you know, I spent some time wavering, if you will. And I remember in college, there was one night when we had a Bible study, and it was from Revelation. It talked about being a fence sitter, you know. And there were different times in college, whether it was in our apartment or friends' places, ministries on campus, that God was always trying to pull at me. What group of friends I had. Because there's my group of friends, thankful to say that each and every one of them I know that I went to college with are saved. Thankful for that. But there was a period in our lives where we were doing things that we chose to do that might not have been glorifying God. And I ran from God. But God brought me back.
Amen.
Through the help of some others, through what I would call our first arms around snail we had in 1998. That's when I rededicated my life to serving and living for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And have been trying my best to do so since then.
Amen.
I won't say doing so, because there are times I fail every day. But I am forgiven. And He continues to forgive. What He wants of us is to be less of ourselves and more like Him as we grow. We'll never be Him. But that's the decision that matters more than anything. Repent and believe. Put your faith in the one that can save you. And that's Jesus. That's why He came into the world. He didn't come to be a great teacher, though He was a great teacher. He didn't come just to do miraculous things, though He did. He performed an immense amount, number of miracles. He even said that His people were going to do more than Him, if you read Scripture. But what matters more than anything is that Jesus came into the world to seek and to save that which was lost. And that was me, and that was you. And that's the decision that matters more than anything. I heard it said one time, somebody was interviewing Billy Graham, what is the greatest need in the world today? This was a few years back, and when they were speaking of hunger, I think they were speaking of disease at the time, so people need water. And Billy Graham said, those are all people's needs. He said, but I believe that there's enough of water, there's enough food, there's enough of all that thing in the world to provide for everyone, but the number one thing we need is salvation. Because sin separates us from God, and sin keeps those, in most situations, from getting the things they need. And that's not necessarily on them, sometimes it's government, or whatever. And right now, our lives are kind of being drilled down, if you will. Kind of some of the stuff that we kind of concern ourselves with, if you've ever heard of what I'm talking about, maybe some, if you drill down to things, you get down to kind of the root of things, our lives are kind of being drilled down to the root of things, if you will, to our own home life, what's going on within the walls of our homes, and in our individual lives. What are we doing there with the relationships we have there? What was such a priority in our lives? My goodness, I'll tell you right now, I thought maybe God was going to take me and talk about the things we worship in our lives, and man, I love sports. I love baseball. We've already started now. The Braves will be on just about every night. I love to watch the Braves, my son and I, my wife. My daughter, not quite as much, but she likes a little sports here and there. But man, sports, and it's kind of, if you will, become, I thought about it as an idol in my life. And I just wonder, and I'm not necessarily saying this is what God is doing in our lives to take all the idols away, but maybe it is something that He's trying to teach us as we learn. You know, what have I put in place of Him? Is it sports? Is it a hobby I have? And I don't want to say hobbies are bad, but all I'm saying is priority in our lives. There's nothing wrong with loving the Braves, loving the Georgia Bulldogs, Atlanta Falcons, Hawks, whoever you love, Alabama, Georgia Tech, whoever you love. Darren just raised his hands back there for that Georgia Tech. Darren loves Tech. Darren loves sports too. I know he can relate. Some of you others that are here and out there love sports, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But I think God wants us to take a look at ourselves, figure out what we have priority. Why we're in this place where we're drilled down to what we have is most important. And take a look inside. And so I would say to you, what are you trusting today? Are you putting your faith in your job? Your freedom? Because some of our freedoms have kind of been limited now. Man, we love to go. I mean, I say that, we go, we're kind of homebodies. But it's just that everybody maybe has that feeling that you're not able just to go and do as you please when you want to. And as Americans, we love freedom. We love to do and go as we please. But have we put that in a place of worship? Do we worship the government? Are we trusting in the government for us today? Trusting in activities and sports. I would encourage you today to decide to repent and believe. And it kind of goes hand in hand with what the message is today, if you will. I've got three points in the outline, but it comes down to a person believing in this story today. So there's a few points that I bring out of this story from Acts chapter 16. So if you have your Bible, whether you have your Bible, physical Bible, or maybe you have a device that you're looking on, I would encourage you, read your Bible if you have a physical Bible. There's nothing wrong with reading it online, but something about flipping the pages, and just something about that. And that's just a personal feeling for me. But read your Word, no matter what, it's still the Word of God, whether it comes from an electronic device or off the page. I would encourage you to read. So as I said on the outline, as I was preparing to preach this Sunday, I've been seeking God in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. And I'm really not going to get too much into the details about the virus, experts' opinions, all that kind of stuff. That's for other people. Like I said earlier, there's places I've been reading and studying that's brought me to this place today. But what can I do, just a regular, ordinary follower of Jesus Christ, in the midst of this virus? There's some things about life that are different now. And we want normalcy to come back sooner rather than later, right? But what can I do at this point in time? There's a great song. If you Google things or search things out, look it up. I don't know, John, you may remember Chris Rice. There's a song called The Power of a Moment. And we're in a moment's time right now. And so it doesn't feel like a moment, I know that. But they're in a space of time right now. And the song he says something about teach me the power of the moment. What is God trying to teach us in the midst of this moment, this season, if you will, in time? And I believe Paul has something for us to learn from him right now in Acts chapter 16. So if you got your Bible, turn over there to the Bible. And we're going to be in verses 16 through 34. Paul and Silas in prison. Now it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with the spirit of divination met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation." And this she did for many days. But Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And he came out that very hour. When her master saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, "These men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe." Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off her clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And then they had laid many stripes on them. They threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. So how you see where Paul and Silas are now. They're in prison. So this is their situation, and Paul knew what it was like to be in a situation like this. He knew what it was like to be isolated. He knew what it was like to be beaten, to be hurt, to be physically hurt, to be separated from society, to be put in prison, to be in jail, to have his security, if you will, taken away. Some of you probably feel that way right now, to feel isolated, to feel taken out of society. Maybe you feel physically worn down from it all, from the news, when you continue to get an update. We've had this many today hospitalized. We've had this many today die. We've had this many test positive for it, and it just keeps going gradually up and up. It's like I said about that information, it just keeps punching you. If you ever watch a boxing match, it was cool last night. Bo had never seen Rocky III, and you know, Rocky was on. And Rocky's just hammering away at Mr. T one time toward the end of the movie. Man, it's like body blows, like Rocky was delivering to Mr. T, Clubber Lang, if you know the movie. But those body blows, that information just keeps coming in. And like it wore out Mr. T in the movie, to the point he eventually went down, it brings us down. And we feel, gosh, Lord, when is this are we going to get to that? You know, they keep telling us the curve's going to flatten. I said, well, I won't talk too much about the virus, but here I go. Are we going to get to that point, right? Are we flattening the curve, they keep telling us about all these new words we hear? And that stuff wears on. It can beat us down. I certainly don't necessarily want to compare it to Paul being thrown in not what we would call a prison today. The prison back then was very dark and dreary. He was thrown in an inner prison, which I would say is probably more isolated and the standard, if you will. But I can't imagine it was had a bed with a concrete floor, or those kind of things that we might have today. But what I want to look at is where Paul's at. He's in this situation. He's in prison, right? What do they do in the midst of it? And that's where I'm going with this. What do we do in the midst of where we are, the situation we find ourselves? And maybe it's not just for today, anytime we go through a situation in life or we're in a struggle. Whatever we're going through, whether we're impacted by the virus or not, we are impacted. Whether that's through our job or whatever. The fact that we're worshiping online instead of being here, it's not what we consider normal and what we want normal. So what can I do in the midst of it? Verse 25. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Man, that's so key right there in that verse. The prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. Paul called with a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for the light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" So before I go there, I'm going to stop here. In the midst of having been beaten, falsely accused, maybe not falsely accused, they did what they called the demon out of, but the people who were using the slave girl for their own profit didn't care for it, so they did make false accusations against them, and it turns out they ended up just beating them and putting them in prison, stripping them, if you will. But instead of turning into themselves, feeling sorry for themselves, and I don't want to minimize where you're feeling right now. We all have a sense of feelings right now. But instead of struggling with the facts of their circumstance, Paul and Silas chose to pray.
Amen.
So I'll encourage you first to worship. Pray. Read. sing, as it tells there. Spend some time worshiping God every day.
Amen.
Whatever level that is for you. Maybe you weren't spending too much time each day doing so in the past. Or maybe in the midst of this, God is saying, give me 20 minutes each day. Give me 10 minutes each day. Give me an hour, whatever that is for you. But spend that time. Since you're already kind of isolated and closed in, we have more time. And sometimes it's easy for us to go, start zooming through all this stuff, different TV stations, and people say, watch this, that, I'm binge watching, whatever. Binge watch the Word of God, I guess I'd say. Binge on the Word. Binge in prayer. Sing a song. Listen to some songs. I mean, that's something I've been doing. Some songs that I haven't listened to in a while. The other night I was listening to How Great Is Our God by Chris Tomlin. I said, I'm sharing that. I just want to share it. But it's a great, great, there's so many great songs of faith, like Wayne sang earlier. But secondly here, as I read again, it says, then he called for the light, ran in, fell down, trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? So they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household. I want to tell you, obey the Lord in the midst of this. Be obedient to God, what he's calling you to. Whatever he's calling you to in your life, be obedient to him. And I would even say to abide by the law. I know it's difficult sometimes. We have questions about what information we get, and all of us do on a certain level. We were having a discussion earlier about all of this, the history of it and stuff, and it's really legitimate. But I would encourage you, and I think that's something as leaders we try to do, you know, so long as they're not telling us you're not allowed to preach, you're not allowed to share the good news of Jesus Christ anymore, as long as they're just asking us to really kind of abide by the law, which I mean, if you say, we'll ride on the right side of the street and obey traffic laws, and you're abiding by the law in normal situations anyway, so long as they're not telling us to shut down our church, on a certain level they've asked us not to meet in large groups. We can kind of go back and forth on that. But what in the midst of all this, we want to do what we felt like is best for you guys in obeying not only the laws we have, but more importantly, obeying God. And we believe in the midst of that, continuing to preach and have service and sing and worship is what we can do in the midst of it.
Amen.
And what you can do is to be here. Is to set aside that time, because I think some of the concerns, legitimate concerns, are that this becomes a habit, right? That it becomes habit forming that on Sunday we're not going to the house of God, that we enjoy being in our pajamas. We enjoy being in our shorts and sitting on the couch and watching it. You know? And I got to tell you, I can't wait for Sunday when we can all be back here together. Amen. I don't know when it's going to be, but I think it's going to be exciting. I think it's going to be an amazing day. And we probably all took it for granted in a certain way, shape, or form, maybe. Sometimes. Maybe other days, not as much as others. Man, I don't think I'm going to take it for granted anymore. Be thankful to be in the house of God.
Amen.
On Sunday morning, Wednesday nights. And I miss the kids. I miss, you know, the fist bumps and just sharing and listening to those kids and teaching a little bit. And I know Wayne misses doing music with them and the other leaders to help. We miss them. So, in the midst of where we are right now, obey what God is calling you to do, whether that's to grow in Him. I think God's going to, if you read history, and I'm not really someone who studies great history, Ralph probably is, maybe our historian, him or John here, but I believe I've heard that many great things have come out of isolation. Books, literature, discoveries, inventions, maybe I have to do better study on that, but I think God could really burst some cool new ideas out of all of this. Ministry opportunities. I've got some things that God's put in my head that maybe we can do as a church that we've not done before. So I don't know. Just have to obey God and what He's calling us to do.
Amen.
Be careful of the voices we're listening to out there. And the last thing I would tell you is to serve and share with others. As I finish reading here, it says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved, you and your household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in the house. And he took them that same hour of the night, washed their stripes, and immediately he and his family were baptized. Now when he had brought them into the house, he set food before them and he rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household. So all this led up to this decision for the jailer in this story here. Paul and Silas's unfortunate circumstance to where it led to their being stripped, beaten, and flogged, and thrown into prison to the point of they did abide by the law, if you will. The doors were flung open, and they could have taken off. But something about it, they had already called attention to what God was doing in their lives by worshiping and singing. Because the other prisoners, if you remember back there in that verse, it said they were listening to them. And when that earthquake happened, those doors flung open, and the jailer thought, "I'm ruined, I'm going to kill myself before they do something far worse to me." Because that's what he knew was going to happen. But Paul and Silas did not go anywhere. Paul called out. What's so interesting there is no one else did either. And there's a whole other lesson in that, I think, for us. But there's a lesson there for some in leadership, even in your home as parents. If your kids are following you, what you're doing. Are you full of panic? Are you full of anger? Are you questioning everything? It's okay to question. Hope you do. But our children are watching us in the midst of this. That's who's got the most eyes on us right now. If your parents or anybody that you really have in contact with, maybe it's friends. This goes to you on social media too. Are you putting out there panic? Is everything that you post about panic? Or are you trying to impact others with the goodness and greatness of Jesus Christ?
Amen.
And I will tell you this. If there's people that you keep seeing that are putting out junk, whatever it is, just unfollow them. Block that mess. You're like, "Well, I'm trying to have an impact." To a certain point, you kind of have to shake the dust off your feet, social media-wise, if you will. You can have an impact, but then there's a certain point you say, "I cannot deal with that." And you don't have to, maybe it's a 30-day, there's something you can do for 30 days. Maybe just shut it off, period, I don't know. But so many of us are using that to get information. You know, I do Twitter a lot, so there's a lot of things that I follow on Twitter. There's a lot of great preachers that are on Twitter that I follow and have great words. There's a lot of news organizations, weathermen, I like to follow the weather, just whatever. But sometimes you just have to block it. And for me, it's just blocking all of it out anyway. But our words matter. What we share matters. What we give out matters to people. Because people are fine-tuned to what God's people are doing. John said last week as he was preaching, having so many gospel conversations, the opportunity for us is there. You know, if you're out in the stores, people are hungry or looking. And it's a great opportunity. So we've kind of limited now. I believe God's calling us in the midst of a revival coming soon.
Amen.
I believe right now we're in the midst of finding that personal revival, individually and as families. God wants to revive the church in America and in the world. God is tired of us being apathetic. He's tired of us sitting on our hands. He wants to use the church to reach a lost and dying world. And that's us. Revival starts in the church. But we can't be concerned about what someone else is with. I remember a great thing from the past. If you remember back when the governor of Alabama had the Ten Commandments he was having that fight, and they were wanting to remove, and ultimately it ended up being removed. Remember the preacher Brian Wright, followed right from the heart. Something back then, he said, he agreed with the fact that they wanted it to be posted in there. But he said, how many of us that are getting so upset that they're removing it there, even have it posted in our homes, or even know what they say? See, we love to grasp onto that kind of stuff as long as it's someone else and we can jump up and down about it. But everything about our relationship with God begins in our house. Just don't complain about it if the city of Snellville or the city of Loganville or Grayson or Decula or Lilburn has the Ten Commandments posted there if we're not posting them in our homes. If we don't know them in our homes, if our kids don't know them, what are we saying? Then you're saying, well, the government's supposed to tell me what I'm supposed to know about the Bible. If you're saying that the city of Snellville should have it posted, yet I don't have it in my house. There's so much to think about. There's so many layers of this. And man, God's really just got so much stuff that I probably could keep on. And I'd go all over the place and chase rabbits. And John Goode's not here. He used to in Sunday school. He'd pull me back from chasing those rabbits when I chased the rabbits. So. But it's a time really to serve those in your home. Serve your wife, husbands. Love your wife. Don't degrade your wife. Don't belittle your wife. Love her like you love the church. Wives, love your husbands. I won't speak on behalf of wives because I'm not one here. But as a father and as a husband, man, there's a way God wants you to love your family. And you can serve them in your home. They're not there to serve you. You serve them. Be a servant leader in your house. As I finish up here, first and foremost, repent and believe. I shared that with you earlier. You can't live out your faith in Christ if you don't have faith in Christ. It all begins with a decision to receive Him, put your faith in Him, and determine that you're going to be a follower of Christ. You need salvation. You need to be saved. Everyone is a sinner. The Bible tells us all sin and come short of the glory of God. That means all, every single one of us. No matter if we're Loganville or Snellville, Grayson or Lilburn, or Decula, Mountain Park, Lawrenceville, Georgia, the United States, or the world. All have sinned. There's no one that has not sinned. If you've not sinned, take a look at the Ten Commandments and find one of those in there. God's not been number one in your life, sin. Read over in James, if you broke one, you've broken them all. Everyone's a sinner. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Bible says, previous to that in Romans, God demonstrated His love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Jesus died for us. Christ died for us, for me. So you got to repent and believe. And then in the midst of all this, that would be my prayer. If it takes a virus pandemic to get saved, praise the Lord.
Amen.
I would hope that for you today. That would be my number one prayer for everyone. But secondly, follow those steps that I believe Paul kind of gave us here through this story. Worship, to obey, and to share with others. Live out your faith in unusual times. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, I thank you for the opportunity this morning to share your word. Lord, I just feel like there's so many things that burst forth in my heart, Lord God, that I really could share. And there's so many different directions we could go. Lord, I believe that you're going to use Ralph, John, Darren, and Philobia over the next few weeks in immense, greater ways than we can even imagine, Lord God. That's what you want in their lives, for them to preach your word to the people.
Amen.
Lord, I lift them up to you today as they prepare to preach. Whatever the circumstances is, and we don't know, there's still some unknowns. So Lord, whether it's a largely online service to the point where it's back to where we're partially local, whatever it is, Lord God, they would preach your word. Thankful for those men. Lord, today my prayer would be that those that are listening online, Lord, that they've heard this story from Acts about Paul and Silas and their circumstance and where they were. Lord, as your people, I would pray that we would worship you in the midst of troubling times, of the unknown, some level of isolation, if you will. You're not necessarily exactly the same as Paul, but on a certain level. Lord, there are those that may be out there that are more isolated than others, Lord, due to sickness. Maybe they're unable to be here on a regular basis. Lord, all of us can feel closed in at times. Lord, in the midst of it all, may we worship. May we sing. May we pray. May we seek your face in it all, Jesus. May we obey you, God, what you call in our lives. And may we share and serve others in the capacity that we can. Help the fathers out there, like myself, to be servant leaders in their homes, as well as the moms, the boys and girls that live in their homes, to obey their parents, listen to their parents. May us as parents model to our kids, to young people, servant heart, a servant attitude, and an attitude that would honor and glorify you, Lord God. Father, my prayer today, Lord, if there's one listening online today, Lord, they've come to a place in their lives, they've tried it all. They've sought it all, they've looked for wisdom in books, and authors, and novels, and knowledge and information out on the internet. They've tried it all. They sought salvation in a bottle, in a pill, in a habit. They sought glory in their job, in their hobby, in their sport. And Lord, at the end of the day, leave you empty. You may have joy for a season if you have an exciting ball game, if you will. When the game is over, the ball's not being thrown around, where are you at? God, I would pray that today might be the day of salvation.
Amen.
For a lost soul out there. That they would look at themselves and say, you know, I believe what the Bible says. I believe that I am a sinner. Sin is anything that separates me from God. I pray that the Holy Spirit would convict us to know that we're sinners. If you've come to that place where the Spirit in your life has brought you under conviction that you're a sinner, that you're separated from God, but today you want to put your faith in Him, that you can believe that Jesus came into the world, died on the cross for your sins. The Bible says that God loved the world. Whosoever believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Like I said earlier, all have sinned, but all of those are also whosoever's. And whosoever is anybody that would call on the name of the Lord, just like the jailer in the story today. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, puts their faith in him, will be saved.
Amen.
Admit that you're a sinner. Believe that Jesus came into the world, died on the cross for your sins, and rose again. Confess. Commit your life today to make him Lord and Savior. Ask him to come into your life the best way you know how. And he will. He will save you this day.
Amen.
In the midst of the coronavirus, Jesus Christ is still saving tens and hundreds and thousands all across the world. May today be your day of salvation. If you made that decision today, I would encourage you to share it with someone. Share it with a family member. And if you're watching online, share it to that page, Westside. Share it with Brother John if you need a staff member, a pastor to share with. You can share with him. If you want to share with another leader in the church, you can share with Darren or Ralph or Fawobi or myself. If you want to just share with a friend online. Many of our friends here at Westside, other leaders like Vicki Parker, Lyle Ussery, Janice Ussery, so many others, Barbara Weller, following online, great teachers, Brother Johnny Blaha, if you're a child, you can share with him. I don't know if he's on Facebook, but his wife will share it with him. I know that for a fact. Miss Lane, so many of us care for you out there. Our prayer today as leaders and as a church is that you would put your faith in Jesus. Above anything else you do this day, trust in Jesus for salvation.
Amen.
Father God, help us to live out our faith in troubling times. Help us to seek you in the midst of it all. We would pray that this world, that this virus, Jesus, that you would help cure. Lord, we see every day there's technologies and vaccines that are coming, quicker tests that are coming to identify those that have it. Jesus, I would help you to help the smartest of those people to figure out a cure for this, a vaccine, whatever it is, Lord. That you would help them do that. Because you're still in the miracle business.
Amen.
We don't even think about it sometimes. But Jesus, you are in the miracle business. Miracles happen every day. We would ask for a miraculous thing to be done this day. Jesus, guide us, lead us, direct us, and help us. Jesus, help me. Pastor Ben used to tell us that, pray that prayer, boys and girls. Jesus, help me. Jesus, help us. Jesus, help us all. That's it, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's sing together. This is my desire.
Video or I record that I can share. But Sunday school teachers, check on each other. Y'all are probably doing a much better job than I am. I know the senior ladies are probably the best at it that I've ever seen or heard of. But as men, let's do that too. Sometimes the ladies are much more relational, better at doing that. Let's keep on checking on each other. Let's keep on sharing good things that we can. Let's praise God in the midst of it all. And let's love Jesus and love each other through it all. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for allowing us to have service this morning, Lord God. Thank you for those that are here serving you. doing sound, doing camera work, singing songs, leading us in worship, Lord. And what a great blessing it is to be in your house. And we look forward to the day when we can gather together in this place, the church. Lord, we know the church is not the building. It's not these boards and bricks. Lord, it sure is good to come together and gather. And Lord, we look forward to that day. We pray for those that are online worshiped. Listen today. Bless each one this week. Keep us healthy. Keep us strong. Continue to be with those on the front lines, nurses and doctors and firemen and police and others in service positions. Lord, we do lift up those in the grocery stores and places that are providing food. May you touch them this week. Keep them healthy. Bless those that are sick. Help them to recover. Give us a great blessing this week, Lord God. Give us wisdom. Give us direction. May we live for you. May we live out our faith. May we live for Jesus each and every day of our lives. In the midst of it all, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Have a good day. Thank you.